Right. Hey everyone. So, excuse me. I am Jaison, and I work as an engineer. Just like I'm an engineer at Hasura. So, this talk is about how you can use Hasura, about the features that Hasura has, and how you can use it to very easily develop and deploy applications. Not just React app, actually. For that matter, anything. But I'm gonna talk specifically about React. Alright. So, let's go to brief on Hasura. So, what is Hasura? Hasura is basically a development tool that helps you build and deploy application packages really fast. And it's built on open source components like Docker and Kubernetes and whatnot. Apart from that, we also have a hub or a place wherein the community contributes quick starts or volunteers that you can use to easily get started. All of this will make sense once we proceed to the other part of the session. So the major idea or concept behind Hasura is that when you build an app, there are a lot of things that are almost always repeated, right? Like deployment and a lot of other features that are almost always repeated. So our point, what we did is take those things, automated that for you so that you can concentrate only on your business logic and things that matter for you. Okay? And go, right, let's go. Alright, so for the next part of the session is just going to be a demo, and I'm just going to show you a specific workflow from Hasura, Hasura's endpoint. Alright, cool. So, when you start with Hasura, you first go to this place called hasura.io/hub. As I said, this is the place that has all the quickstart qualities that the community contributes to. Right? It's just a agglomeration of a lot of these stacks. Like, you can have bots, intercom bot, Python Slack bot, and you can just search for JavaScript components or whatever. Right? These are just things put together. Also, apart from that, we also maintain a few official ones that you can just search user code and Hasura, and you just find them. Now, for the purpose of this talk, I have created a website called React Foo. What React Foo has is basically just a simple React app and a Node.js Express app, just Hello World app, apps running that is just set up so that we can just easily get started with it. Right? This is the whole point of Hub. Everything is just set up for you with a simply working thing, and you can just start off. So, the only thing that you need to do to get started with Hasura is firstly sign up and log in, or whatever. Create an account is quite simple, like it's nothing. You just have to click a button and get an account. And the next thing you need to do is install a command line tool called Hasura CLI. And so I already have that installed, so I'm not really going to do that, but that's literally what you have to do. After that, you basically have to copy this command and paste it onto your terminal. So what this command does is that it basically clones this project from Hasura Hub and clones it into your local machine, and then it creates a free Hasura cluster for you. So in this case, the cluster is called Amazing 12. This is where you can deploy your apps and whatnot. Now, so now that we have our project, let's examine the code or let's see what it has. So I'm just going to do that. Alright, so can you guys see? Is it visible? Alright, so anyway, I can go over this as well. So what it has is a conf directory, which we'll get to later, a microservices directory and a migration directory. What matters at this point in time is the microservices directory.
Thank you.
So what matters at this point in time is a microservices directory, which has two folders, API and UI. And so we can look at the code in that. So API is basically the simple Node.js Express app that I was talking about, which just has one thing, which just says hello React Foo from Node.js, right? And the next thing is the UI directory, which is a simple React app that we have. Again, a very very straightforward React app, which is nothing. It just says hello React Foo, and that's it. So now what we can do is go ahead and So now what we can do is go ahead and deploy this. So what does the deployment flow look like in Hasura? So all you have, it's deployment in Hasura is similar to pushing your code onto a remote repository, right? So for example, what I'm doing here is I added the changes, so git add, git commit, and add it to my commit history, and then I'm just going to do a git push Hasura master. What this does is deploy your code. Now we'll see what that means after the deployment is done. So it's basically taking all the configuration from your local directory and applying it onto the cluster. So the deployment is done. So now, as I told you, right, we had two microservices. One was called API and one was called UI. So we just have to type down Hasura microservice open API. So I'm going to open up API right now. Now, this is your Node.js app deployed live on a public URL that is accessible by everybody over HTTPS on the API subdomain just with a git push command. This is all you have to do. You have to just start it. It took me a minute to do this. That's it. Like, if I had an account at Hasura and if I had the command line, this is how long it takes to deploy something like that. Secondly, I'm going to open up the React app, which is the UI. Again, the React app deployed live over HTTPS. All of this handled for you with like no trouble at all. Now, what I'm going to do next is make a few changes. So let's do that. I'm just going to go to our React app and change it. Just type changes. In this case, I'm going to say Hasura presenting and React food. Incredibly fast typing, but. Again, so deployment is same flow. Git add, git commit, and git push. Okay, this is deployed. Now, if I just go back, refresh the page, changes again. That was effortless, in my opinion. Alright, so now the thing is, the React app or whatever app that you have published or deployed is, like in this case, the React app is on the UI subdomain, right? Like it says UI dot whatever. Now I want to change that. Let's see how easy that is. So this is where the conf directory comes into play. So I go to the conf directory here. And so what the conf directory has is all the configuration that you want to apply to the cluster locally in your local machine. So each time you change it and you deploy, it's all version control you put in your repository. Right? So it's very easy to revert back, move back and forth, whatever you want. So in this case, I'm going to go down to a file called routes.yaml and scroll down, find my microservice called UI and simply change it from UI to something like React Food. And again, git add, git commit, and git push us. Incredible that we speak. And that's done. You go back. As you can see, some UI is no longer valid. So, I mean, ideally, you don't have to do this. You can just go change UI to React Food. But in this case, I'm just going to for theatrics. Open it up, and now it opens up React Food. Right? Again, this is also done. So, these are simple things that it has, right? Like to deploy apps, these are simple things. Now, so the deployment part of your application is this simple. Like we have completely automated that for you. So if you were to start, like how many of you guys are developers who like to actually develop every day? Oh, this is awesome. So because other conferences like completely happy to develop. Alright, so how many of you guys are, like front-end developers who do React or so for you guys, what is this, right? Like if you know JS, this is all you need to do, like you are just done, right? But this is not all, right? This is not all. What do all the applications, what do normal applications, this is the deployment part of the application, but what about the other features? Like, usually there are things like authentication that you almost always need to do. Then there are like storing your state or storing your app data in your in a database, right? So performing CRUD on that database, basically creating, reading, updating, deleting things from that database. Then you may have things like you may want to upload and download files, something like an AWS S3 bucket, or you may also have to send like an SMS or email. Your users, right? These are all also things that ideally why should we do this over and over again, right? This also should be automated first. So that's where the Hasura API console comes in. So every time you get a cluster, you also get a Hasura API console. So the API console is basically a place where you can explore these backend components that Hasura gives you out of the box. So these are just all of these are just HTTP instances. REST API is just open for you. You can just try it out and use it anywhere, however you want. So your link data or what does matter, what is pretty cool is the API Explorer, where you just have a list of all the APIs that are available, so you can just try them out over here. You can literally just try them out over here and then do whatever you want with it, right? So you have like data APIs, you have authentication, which is like username, password, social login, which would be like Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, GitHub. Then you have mobile OTP, mobile password, email password, and then like for logged in users, you have some APIs. Then you have file APIs, file storage, which is like upload, download, delete, notification, which would be like send, SMS, and email. All of these are just here, you can just try it out and it'll just work. Now, did the video just catch up? I actually said about this. Alright, so these are the APIs that are given to you that just work out of the box, right? But okay, one more thing, right? Authentication, always there. Why create the UI all over again if you're just developing? And unless you have like a product that you are really, really worried about, like with the with your colors and with your fonts and all that, you can just start off with like a for development purposes or even for production for that matter. You should ideally have some kit or something that just works out of the box even for authentication, right? So we went on ahead and created this thing called the Auth UI kit. This is also highly customizable. There are like two themes at this point in time. There are two themes, like a dark theme, a light theme. And again, you go to the comp directory, make a few changes, you deploy, and your screen will also change accordingly, right? So in this case, I'm going to go with the default login, which is username, password. So as you can see, there's like login, there's a sign up page. And how the auth kit works is that it basically takes a redirect URL. So after successful authentication, it will route you to that URL, right? So what it does is basically, after successful authentication, set a cookie and then route you to that URL. So what I'm doing right now is I set as our React foo app as the React app as the redirect URL. What I'm going to do is I don't have an account yet, so I'm going to create one. So I'm going to sign up for this app. So I'm going to call it Jaison Test. Which is C is also. And password is. Yeah. So as you can see, it redirected us to our React app. Right? All right. Awesome. So these are the components that I've given to you. Right now. What we're going to do next is that now we know how to deploy, now we know what features are present. What we're going to do next is use these features and build a very simple app. And what better app to build than the To-Do app? So to build this To-Do app, there are three major things that we need to do. So firstly, I want a UI built for it. So I've gone ahead and built a UI. Secondly, I want to link up my Auth UI kit to my React app so that I have authentication. And finally, I want to persist the to-dos that are put up by other users into the database so that there's a state, right? That user A can log in, he'll have a set of to-dos. User B can log in, that's another set of to-dos, right? So let's go ahead and do that. So first thing, I've created the component. It's called a simple to-do component. I've just basically replaced the div that I had earlier with this to-do component. It's very simple, quite... So no, ideally, like it's not really that good looking, but yeah, for this session it will work. So I've added that component. Again, the same old thing. I'm gonna do a git add, git commit. This baffles me, this period which I did. And git push Hasura master. This is gonna happen a lot, guys. Git push Hasura master is gonna happen a lot. By the end of this talk, if you get anything, it should be git push Hasura master. Yeah, so it's deployed now. Now if I just go to our app and simply refresh the page, as you can see, this is a simple to-do thing that I've made. And you can just add to-do. I mean, nothing really works. This is just maintaining state right now. So if I just refresh the page, all this will go away. But you can do simple things like add to-dos, you can mark them as completed, you can delete them, etc. Right? Alright, awesome. So now this is done. The next thing we needed to do was I wanted to sync up the auth UI kit to our To-Do app, right? So how would that work? Like the auth UI kit sets up a cookie, redirects me to my React app. Now my React app needs to know. I mean, it works fairly simple. Like the auth UI kit will just work. If you start off from the auth UI kit, you simply get the redirect URL and you reach my app. But how does the app know whether the user is logged in or not? Obviously, use the cookie. What you would do is that you can actually go ahead to the API console and you will see that there's one API called user information. So what this does is that when you give it a session token, it will basically give you the information about the logged in user. So the session token is basically, so in this case, I'm just adding like an admin token. So the API console basically provides you with an admin token that you can just use. So if you do that, see, the response would be the email. The email, the auth token, username, the user ID, which is equivalent to the Hasura ID, and the roles that are assigned to this user. In this case, this is like user and admin. Alright, so this is that. So what I've done is I've gone ahead and implemented that in the React app. So I'm just gonna, I mean, this is just tiny things. I just put like a loading indicator and whatnot. I've basically included this with the same API. And instead of using the auth header, I'm just saying it credentials include so that the cookie gets in. And finally, I mean, this is not really clean code, this is just used for the purpose of this demo. What I'm doing is basically, if the get user information API returns unauthorized, I simply redirect to my auth bucket, right? And this is practically what it would take to do this. And I think I've added like tiny other things like show loading screen or just tiny things. Alright, so I've done this. Again, we do the same thing, git add, git commit. Yeah, think a lot when I comment messages. Anything. You can write dirty code, but comment messages. Alright, so again, get push Hasura master. Alright, deploy. Again, I don't need to. So as you can see, it redirects to the auth UI kit. If you're not logged in, I am going to. Yeah, that's because of the code I've written. You can just handle it. So this redirect that happens for a while, right? So if you just handle the state properly, it will not show this, it will show things later. This is because the enter element got rendered first because of the, instead of the ruler. Alright, so that is done. Again, no database added to it yet. But this works. I think in the video I went a little overboard and I was like, no, let's show this again. So in incognito mode. Same thing works because there's no session set in incognito mode, right? Alright. So part two done. Part three is the database, right? So I wanna what we're gonna do is we're gonna create a table. So Hasura basically has a Hasura backend component, which is a database that you can create, so you can create tables very easily. So go to the data tab in the API console, go ahead and click on add table and call it to ID, which is our text, so unique ID, value, which is the value of the to-do, is completed. And this is the boolean. And user ID, which is the ID of the user who is going to create this table, right? And the primary key for this table can be ID. I've created this. Now, so if you see, like this table is already created and this is done. So, another thing that matters a lot is that when you create a database, when you create tables, random people should not be allowed to get data from it. There's a matter of security that you have to put. You have to put some permissions on your table that not everyone should be allowed to query data. So, this is another thing that comes by default with Hasura. So, every table that you create, by default has an admin permission, so only admin users are allowed to query. I have to go personally add a user permission to it. So what I'm going to do right now is, I'm going to add a user permission saying that unless this is a user, do not allow him to insert any data into this table. Similarly, I'm going to say unless this is a user, same permission, do not allow him to select data. And in this case, I want to select everything, like all the columns, ID, value, is completed, and the user ID. Update, again, same constraint, but in this case I'm going to say do not let him update the ID and the user ID because ID is unique and user ID is my own, right? So I should not be allowed to edit the user ID. Finally, the same thing for delete as well. So I should be allowed to delete my own to do. Cool, so the permissions have been applied. Now we will go back and have a look at browsers again. And so yeah, I'm going to go to insert row and just insert some value, right? So since there is no entry right now, I'm just going to have like ASDFG is ID, value can be test to do, is completed is false, and user ID is 1. Admin users are given a user ID of 1 by default. So as you can see here, the table is inserted. So this one is the database that is given to you, second one is the permission that you can apply. The third thing is, every time you create a table, instantly you get JSON APIs on it. So you don't really have to go write an ORM, you have an ORM or something to like contact a database. You have instant JSON APIs, very intuitive JSON APIs that you can just use to query this database. And I mean, the APIs are quite intuitive, take my word for it, I'll show it to you also. But even like to make your learning curve a little faster, we have also added this thing called the query builder, which will basically help you query data from a database. So in this case, we can basically have a look at that. So I'm going to say type select. I'm going to say table to do, and then I'm going to say columns. What I want is ID, I want value, I want is completed, and I also want the user ID. Yes. Select and to do for role anonymous is not allowed. This is because I've not really added a auth token, right? I've not added the session token to my header yet. So this is not allowed. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and add the admin token. And there you go. This is the tool that we added, right? Similarly, you can just explore this through the query builder and just go build other queries. Apart from that, we also have a button called the generate API code. So what you need to do is, this is the API that you just built, that you've tried out and it works perfectly, right? You want to have this in your client side code or some code, some program that you write. So what you can do is, you can just go here, select from a list of languages that we have, and you keep adding one language like quite frequently, new language frequently. I'm going to select JavaScript fetch because that's what I'm going to use. And that's it. I'm going to copy this and paste it on my code, and this is how it works. So what I've done is I've basically gone ahead and done this. Again, in this case, what we're going to do is we're not really going to use the auth header. We're going to use credentials into so that the cookie gets in. And it's the same thing. So after get credentials, I'm just going to say get to do this format of this memo. So it get to do is like a select query. Then add it to do is like an insert query. Then you have toggle to do, which is like toggle between completed and not completed. Like an update query, which is update is completed to true or false, right? And finally, you have delete to do, which is a delete. Sorry. Once that is done, again we go back to this and yeah. Now, one interesting thing to note over here is that there are a bunch of files inside this migration directory. So, if you're ever building a production app or if you're building like a serious app and which are used by users, you would ideally have two environments, right? One is a production environment and the other one is like a staging environment. So in your production environment, so what you could do is you would try out some features, you'll make some schema changes, you'll add some tables, or you do whatever you want. You do it in a staging environment, you test it out, everything works fine, then you do a migration. Basically, migrate this into onto your production environment, right? So what this does is each time I made some changes onto the API console, these files, these .yaml files are basically just added to my migrations directory, which keeps track of the changes that I've made. So what is happening right now is that, and these are just SQL commands that are just executing, right, in the console basically. So these have just been added as migration. So this is like the create to do command, create to do table command, and apart from that you also have the permissions one, and all those are just added as migration. So now in case you want to move to another environment, you simply just have to change your cluster and push to that cluster, and this change will just get applied. And not only this, now let's say I had added these migrations to my file that I can push that as a quick start. Somebody else who starts with this quick start will also get this. So he will no longer have to build like a to-do table or add permissions to it or whatever. So I'm going to add my migrations to my Git history. I'm going to say add migrations. So that this is tagged in our version control. And I'm going to add the changes that I've made to the to-do component. And it pushes us on us. Alright, so this is the button. And if you just refresh this page, see now that indicator. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go to incognito mode, install it, and show you guys like a complete flow, including the UI kit. So now we've already joined everything together, right? So I go to the login screen. I log in, I have no to-dos. Notice that the admin to-dos have been done because I don't really have permissions to read them. Added a bunch of to-dos. I'm going to delete this. Now here the same session, right? Because I logged in with the same user, the same session is active here as well. And I refresh the page and the to-dos are active here as well. Okay. The theatrics. You go back, start another new incognito window. And this time I'm gonna log in with another user. Or not log in, sign up. So I'm gonna say Jaison test 2. And passwords. Don't tell anyone my password. And as you can see, the to-dos that are added to the other users are not no longer there. So this is because this user does not have passwords, right? So I'm gonna add some random to-do. And if you just go back to the previous page, refresh this, not there, right? So I'm gonna mark that as completed. Now if you go back to your so I go back here and if you just go to the data tab and just check out this thing, you will see that all the new tools have been added, the user IDs are different for each of them. And this is it. So with this, we've actually built a whole to-do app with authentication, with permissions over like HTTPS, all of this effortlessly, right? Like I only needed, the only thing that I actually needed to do was know how to make API calls in my client, which is React app, know how to build my UI, and that's it. Everything else was just click, you just had to add tables, right? Everything else was quite intuitive, in my opinion. So this is done, right? Now, as every good developer would do, you contribute back to the community, right? Because I started from a quick start, why not give back to somebody who wants to build a to-do app? So that is also quite simple. All you have to do is go to your project directory and click on, and write down a sub-publish. It'll say you're publishing as your username, and you select a name for your project or for your good start. In this case, I'm going to call it React2. You can just select like a default version. That's it. And this is published. So now if you just go... And there you have it. So ideally you will go here, then you have an account, so you can go change your description so that people know how to actually deploy this. So in this case, the only thing that, so since the migrations are also added to this, if they simply deployed, they also have a to-do table already created with the permissions and all that. So the only thing that they actually need to do is go to the React code, which will also be there, and simply change the cluster name. So I got the cluster Amazing 12, right? When you create your own, you'll get your own cluster. So you simply have to change that cluster name, and that's about it. And it will just work out of the box. So this we come to the end of the demo. So I hope, at least in my opinion, this was very effortless. Right? I mean, it was nothing. Like, we basically started from Hasura. We took a quick start, bare nothing. It had just two apps running on it. We changed the React app subdomain very easily. Again, it did push command. And then we added like a simple to-do component to this. We use the auth UI kit for authentication. We use the database to persist the to-do and finally publish this also. All of this in under like 30 minutes. Or like if you are really good in React, no, this is not really taking much time. If you do this once, the learning goes like it's quite straightforward. But what about React Native Developers? Right? React Native Developers the same thing. All you have to do is go to Hub, find like a quick start that works for you, like some language that you know, and you just need to know the server side framework and how to use it. So if it's React Native, you know JavaScript. Quite safe for you, right? You have to do that. You have to make some required changes. You can either directly use the data APIs in your app, or you can, like, let's say you want to implement push notifications. In which case, you write your own custom Node.js application, which will basically use that same to set your push notifications or whatnot, right? But this is about it. Like, all you need to know is to build your app and nothing else. Everything else is actually done for you. Everything that can be automated has been automated. And there are new things that we're looking at, but at least at this point in time, this flow is fairly straightforward. And so what I want from you guys is to go to Hasura, sign up. It's nothing, it's a click over button, just sign up. You will immediately get two free clusters. And these clusters, like you, when I say two free clusters, like two free clusters at a time. So the point in Hasura is that do not treat these clusters as a pet, like they're like cattle, right? So you don't like it, delete it, create a new one. Doesn't matter. You have two free clusters that you can use for deployment, for development and all things. You can go to Hasura Hub, search for a stack boilerplate that puts all these things. Like, so we have things like Jupyter Notebooks and all that stuff, right? Which is quite painful to set up otherwise. And you can just, or if you cannot find a good stack that you want, just ask us. And we would really like to build it for you. And it's not that much of an effort to build a good stack. And finally, we are looking for feedback. We want feedback from developers like you, because this is for developers like you. It makes Everything quite simple. And even if you like it or if you do not like it, give us your feedback. If you don't like it, tell us why you don't like it, so that we can solve this for you, right? And talk to us. We like talking to developers, so we like getting feedback. So you can email us. So let's say you have like a product that you want to build and you want some guidance on it. Email us at build@hasura.io. You can contact us on Facebook or Twitter at HasuraHQ. You can contact us on our public Slack channel. Or you can just go to our website and there will be like a blue button on the right hand side. It's the intercom button. Just click on that and start talking to us. Alright, so yeah, with this we come to the end of the demo.